Welcome to Summit Online. If this is your first time joining us, I just want to say welcome. We're really glad that you're here. In fact, go ahead and pull out your phone and text the word welcome to 33933 so someone from our team can connect with you. Summit Online is a platform that aims to reach people with the gospel and help them take their next step with Christ. So let me tell you some ways to watch and engage with us. Option one, you can join the live chat on Sunday mornings at live.summitchurch.com. Come connect with other online viewers, engage with the message, and even pray with a live host. Option two, join or host a home gathering and watch on demand on our YouTube channel. For resources on hosting your own home gathering, visit summitchurch.com/next steps and click on service resources. And of course, our end goal for you is that you'd be investing in a local church near you. If you live in the Raleigh-Durham area, be sure to check out all of our locations at summitchurch.com/locations. Or if you don't, text welcome to 33933 to connect with us and we'll help you find a church near you. Service will begin in just a moment, so grab your Bible and notebook and get ready to worship with us today. We're really glad you're here. Hey Summit, can I just say I love getting to meet some of you. Whether you email me, shoot me a DM, or we have a chance to talk on the phone, I love getting the opportunity to connect and hear your story. So if this is your first time, be sure to text welcome. Seriously, go ahead, pull out your phone, text the word welcome to 33933 so we can get to know you. I know so many of us aren't coming to church just for content, but for community as well. So we want to help you find a local church and connect with the community around you. Speaking of connecting, we've actually launched a new ministry here in the Triangle for young adults. So I've asked my friend Andrew to come fill you in on all the details.
Yeah, that's right, Kelsey. And right now, one of the most exciting things that we have going on at our church is the launch of our young adults ministry. This ministry is for anyone in their 20s or 30s. You can be single, you can be married, you can be married with kids. It doesn't matter. We want you to be a part of it. We want to create a community of young adults that is gospel-centered and is focused on getting people connected to the mission of God. Through this ministry, we believe that people can grow as witnesses, family members, and worshipers of Jesus. As a church, we're committed to doing whatever it takes to reach all people, and this includes young adults. We believe that this ministry is one more way that the gospel is going to go forward here in RDU and around the world.
I love that. And you guys just had your, like, opening launch night, right? With like 200 people?
Yeah, we had over 200 people show up. And we believe that our young adults are hungry for both community and mission.
So if we have young adults watching in the Triangle, how do they get connected to this?
That's right. The best way to get connected is to follow our social media page on Instagram, which is SummitRDU_youngadults. That's the best way to get all the information about our content.
Awesome. I love it. And I pray that all of us are just as hungry. We want to see every age group, whether young or old, connecting to the mission of God. So what's your next step? Actually, visit summitchurch.com/commit to consider what that might be for you.
Well, Summit, are you ready to worship? Turn up your volume and let's sing together today.
Proclaim your great name, your great name. Psalm 90 verse 14 says this, "Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days." Summit family, we're going to take a moment and just pray Psalm 90, that we would be satisfied in God's unfailing love, that we might rejoice and be glad all of our days. So wherever you are, whether you're watching at home by yourself or with your family gathering, take these next few moments to confess to God the times when you look elsewhere, when you run to other things to fulfill yourself. Rest and rejoice in the fact that God's track record of love and faithfulness in your life and throughout all history is perfect. And finally, just pray these words, that God would satisfy us with his steadfast love, that we would rejoice and be glad all of our days.
Before our hearts. I was all alone, you met me.
When I didn't know where to turn, you showed me where to go.
Through your word,
you restored me.
Gave me hope.
Filled me with peace.
This verse changed my life.
Well, welcome Summit Church at all of our locations. The video you just saw, we're going to start a new sermon series this week, this weekend called This Verse Changed My Life. Now, some of you might be familiar with this book I'm holding in my hands. Even if you've never been to church before, you probably know what this is. It's a Bible. Others might be new to it. That's perfectly fine. Perhaps some of you have read every single word of this, cover to cover. For some of you others, you might have never found a reason in your entire life to open a Bible, and that's perfectly fine. Some quick Bible trivia here. How many verses, by show of hands, do you think are actually contained from Genesis all the way to Revelation? So if you think there are more than 1,000 verses in the Bible, put your hand up. More than 1,000. Okay, put your hands down. If you think there are more than 10,000 verses in the Bible, anybody? Okay, a few, a little less. How about 20,000? Anybody so bold? Okay, we're down to about 10%, at least here at Capitol Hills. How about 30,000? Any takers on 30,000 verses? Dr. Jones, you're a seminary professor. That's unfair. I know you. Okay. There are 31,102 verses in the Bible. At least in English, the Bible is approximately 611,000 words long. We can count at least 185 songs in the Bible. This Bible that was written over the course of many years, over at least three continents that we know about, that has over 40 authors, most of whom have never met one another. To this day, the Bible is the number one best-selling book of all time, still cashing in about 100 million sales per year. All of that to say, the Bible's pretty awesome. It might have different meaning for you, but either way, it's a pretty important book. I think we can agree upon that. And the thing is, if you were to ask any believer, so again, maybe you're not a believer here, and that's awesome, and I'm so glad you're here, but if you were to ask any believer, somebody that calls themselves a follower of Christ, how they met God, what you're probably going to hear is a single story or a single passage or a single verse that ultimately led them to Jesus. All of these verses, all of these books, 66 of them, all of these chapters. And yet, as one famous pastor said, he said, books usually don't change people, sentences do. And I just wonder, have you ever considered that one sentence or one verse or one word could change your life forever? Now, you can call me crazy, but I believe that when God's word goes forth, it does not return empty. And in Isaiah, it says, God's word accomplishes that which he purposes when it goes forth. And I still believe he's doing that with his word. So today, as his word goes forth, I believe God wants to do something with it that it will not return void. Anybody else believe that? Amen. There are a handful of verses that I personally always come back to. If you know any Christians, they probably call them their life verse. So I've got a handful of these life verses. They're the verses that have ministered to me through tough times. They're the verses that have encouraged me. They're verses that remind me what's most important about God. Ultimately, they are verses that I feel like God wrote specifically to and for me. You might have your own life verse or life verses. But today, this weekend, I'd like to invite you to turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 22. So the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 22, where we're going to look at one of my life verses together. Because I believe that this verse has the potential to change your life the exact same way it has mine. So we're actually going to read the entire story. Genesis chapter 2, if you're familiar with the Bible, is the famous story of Abraham and his son Isaac. It's also the famous story where we get one of the most famous names of God in all of Scripture, which is Jehovah Jireh. The Lord is my provider. When I preach, I usually get a handful of questions after I preach. And inevitably, I'm not saying this for me, I'm saying this to use as an illustration. Inevitably, one of the questions, at least a handful of people come up and say, oh, what's your tattoos of? Well, half my tattoos are from pre-Jesus days. We'll just call them that, okay? So like my whole back's covered. I've got a handful since I became a believer. Well, the most noticeable one on my arm was the first one I got after I became a believer. So I've got kind of the creation of Adam, so God the Father. I've got the Lion of Judah, so that stands for Jesus, God the Son, and then I have a dove for the Holy Spirit, and then I'm not going to pull my sleeve up, but I've got the huge text right here that says Jehovah Jireh. It's always from day one, from the day I got saved, February of 2008, it's been my favorite name of God. I've seen God provide for me in ways that were beyond my imagination. I've seen him provide for me in emotional ways when I felt like I was all alone. I've seen God provide for my wife and I financially in times where I didn't know how we were going to make it. I've seen God provide relationships and community in my life in times that I didn't think Christian relationship was a real thing. And so I just love, love, love this name of God. And my hope this weekend is that you come to know God in the same way that I have come to know him as Jehovah Jireh, that the Lord would also be your provider. Now, in order to understand Genesis chapter 2, we need to know what's kind of gotten us up to this point. So again, we're at the beginning of the Bible, and if we were to go back and read, Genesis 1 through 11 kind of sets up, we'll just call it the basic storyline of the Bible. So the basic storyline of the Bible in its most simplest form is God created everything that is, and then he created mankind to rule the world on his behalf and to live in relationship with him. Well, instead of rule and relationship, humans choose sin and rebellion, and the world spins out of control into violence and death, all leading up to rebellion and the scattering of Babylon in Genesis chapter 11, okay? That's kind of the gist of what's going on. So when we get to Genesis chapter 12, the big question of Scripture is, what is God going to do to rescue and redeem his world in which he has created? There's this massive problem that God needs to fix, and it's natural to wonder, what is God going to do to fix it? Insert Abraham, our guy. So God comes to a guy named Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, and he promises to bless this man named Abraham with land, to bless him with a family, and to make him into a great nation by giving him a son. And ultimately, through that son, God said the entire world is going to be rescued and redeemed and blessed, because through his son's lineage would eventually come Jesus Christ, the Messiah. Now, this sounds incredible, right? So if you're reading through this, this sounds awesome, but if you're Abraham in Genesis chapter 12 receiving this promise, there's a few problems with this. So you get quite excited, you go on this high, and then you realize, well, number one, God, my wife, Sarah, is unable to get pregnant. So it seems like a little bit of a problem when you say we're gonna have a son. Number two, they're both super old. So Abraham and Sarah at this point are about 75 years old, so they're pretty old. And God's like, that's not that big of a problem. No biggie, watch me work, all right? So about 25 years later, when they're about 100 years old, God, as he always does, makes good on his promise, and Abraham and Sarah have a son. Which again, this is just pretty crazy. It's pretty insane, because by this point, Abraham and Sarah are about 100 years old when Isaac is born. So yes, I know you're thinking it. Abraham and Isaac both got diapers for their birthday that year. It's pretty exciting stuff, okay? So by the time we arrive to Genesis chapter 22, this is one happy little family. They've settled in. They've planted roots. They've been blessed. Abraham and Sarah have their miracle child. Life's good. And then this is where our story picks up in Genesis chapter 22, beginning in verse 1. It says, after these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham. And Abraham said, here I am. Now pause for a sec. I just want to be real for a moment, real quick. Two quick things here. First, it says God tested Abraham. Now this is simply just not something we talk about a lot. In fact, what's often and unbiblically taught is that if God loves me and I love him, then nothing bad is ever going to happen to me. That if I love God and God loves me, that I will be blessed, I'll be highly favored, I'm promised health and wealth and happiness. And whether we know it or not, at least in the American West Evangelical Church, we often think that God's love and comfortable life are synonyms. And friend, that could not be farther from the truth. And second, up to this point, Abraham has already shown some radical obedience to God. If we go read Genesis 12 through 22, now he messes up along the way, but he's shown some radical obedience. He's left everything and everyone that was comfortable. He's followed God faithfully. He's attempted the impossible. He's waited 25 years to see a promise fulfilled. So at this point in his life, if I'm Abraham and God comes knocking at my door, I'd be like, babe, I need you to turn the lights off, turn the TV off, act like we're not home, because this is the guy that keeps asking us for stuff, okay? From my Lord of the Ring fans, I'd be like Bilbo Baggins when Gandalf and the dwarves show up knocking and Bilbo tells them, nope, no use for adventures. Nasty, disturbing, uncomfortable things that always make you late for dinner, right? And sure enough, verse 2, this is exactly what God does. Look at this. God says, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. I just want to make sure we all understand what's at stake here. As if sacrificing your own child isn't bad enough. As if giving up your son to be murdered. Your hopes, your dreams, your affections, your blessing, if that isn't bad enough, on top of that, your child's survival is what the entire human race is dependent on, because through Isaac is going to eventually come, y'all been listening? Come who? Jesus. Always Jesus, okay? Always Jesus. And so God comes knocking at his door and he says, I want you to offer up that blessing of a son as a burnt offering to me. Now, the obvious question, we could spend an entire sermon on this. We're not going to do that this weekend. The obvious question is, how in the world could God ask something like this? By a cursory reading, this makes God out to be a capricious God. This makes God out to be a hypocritical God, a willy-nilly God. In some ways, it even feels like an evil God. How could God tell somebody to murder his own son? Again, that's an entire sermon in and of itself, but the simple answer, at least for us this weekend, is that God knew he was never going to let Abraham kill Isaac. For now, for this weekend, for this sermon, the way I want us to read this is that Isaac represents to us the one thing that you love the most. The one thing that you treasure the most. Isaac represents the one thing that you trust the most. The thing that makes life worth living for you. And what God is asking Abraham, and even in this text immediately, there's already some application points. What God often asks us is, are you prepared to love me completely and unconditionally? When you call me Lord, are you willing to give me access to what you love most? Is there anything or anyone that you love that if I asked you for it, you would say no? What's the thing that if God asked you right this moment to offer it up to him would make you tighten your grip on that thing? Maybe it's a relationship. Maybe it's where you live. Maybe it's your future ideal plans you have for your family or for your future. Maybe it's where you work. Whatever you feel yourself tightening that grip on is what we would call an idol. Something that you love more than you love obedience to God. And so here, God says, take that kid that you love so much. Take that career that you love so much. Take that status that you love so much. Get off Instagram for the rest of the year. Take those followers that you love so much. He says, take that good thing that you have turned into a God thing and offer it up to me, because if you don't, you're going to end up destroying your own life, and actually you'll end up destroying the idol, because that idol was never meant to hold the weight that you were putting on it. Only God was meant to hold that weight. Abraham is to offer up his son, his blessing, his future hope. Now look at verse 3. God asks them this. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. Now, I just think it's hilarious. Everybody talks about Abraham's like immediate obedience here and waking up early to go do the thing that God has asked him to do. I think he was just trying to avoid having an awkward conversation with his wife about what he was headed to do. That's what I think he was doing. So I think he was just trying to get up earlier than she was, all right? So he wakes up early. He goes to cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. Verse 4. And on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his Isaac, his son. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife, so they both of them went together. Verse 7, and Isaac said to his father Abraham, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. He said, behold the fire and the wood, but where's the lamb for a burnt offering? Verse 8, Abraham said, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So they went, both of them together. And when they came to the place of which God had told them, Abraham built the altar there, laid the wood in order, and bound Isaac his son, and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." He said, "Here I am." Verse 12, God said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in the thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. And then verse 14, this is my life verse, y'all. So Abraham called the name of that place, "The Lord will provide," Jehovah Jireh. As it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." Goodness gracious. What a story about absolutely incredibly great faith. But ultimately, this isn't a story about great faith from a man named Abraham. It's a story about great provision from our God, Jehovah Jireh. The way we should read this is that the hero of this story is not Abraham. It's God. If we read this over and over, the theme that dominates Genesis chapter 22 is the Lord will provide. The Lord will show his love. The Lord will prove his faithfulness. The Lord will prove that his promises are true. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide. In the original translation of Genesis, the Hebrew more directly doesn't necessarily say the Lord will provide. It says the Lord will see to it. I just want you to think about that attribute, that name of God. He is seeing to it, meaning he sees you. He sees what's going on in your life. He sees what you need. And what this says is the character of God, the very nature of God, whatever, wherever he sees, he is acting. Jehovah Jireh means he is always actively at every moment, forevermore, seeing and providing and acting in your life. I've told you, I've come to know this name, this character of God. I've experienced it over and over and over and over again in my life. But I don't believe Jehovah Jireh is just my name for the Lord today. I believe the Spirit of God has a personal word for you today too. And so as surely as Chick-fil-A is good, I believe the Lord wants to show himself and prove himself as provider today in your life, beginning right this moment. And so with that in mind, taking Genesis chapter 22, using the name Jehovah Jireh, the Lord is my provider, I want to share with you at least three ways that God has changed my life and ways that I believe it can change yours too. So here's number one. Knowing God as Jehovah Jireh means that I can focus on God's promises even when I don't know the particulars. That I can focus on God's promises even when I don't know the particulars. So I've heard it said that faith is often doing what God says even when you don't have all the details. Just hard, right? How many of y'all would consider yourself planners? Like you're going out of town, you're planning every last little thing. You like to know what's going on. You like to know what you're doing tomorrow. I consider myself a planner. My wife is like ultra planner, okay? So we've just now, I've told you before, we have four young kids. We've just hit the point in our life where we're willing to take vacations with our kids. One of the things we've realized is when you take vacations with kids, you have to take like half your home with you. It's insane. And so when we go on vacation, we went to the beach last week for like 3 days. My wife starts packing like a week in advance. It's insanity. And so she's on me. She's like, "Babe, we are leaving next Tuesday at 10:15. Have you packed your bag yet?" I'm like, "No, because it's this week Tuesday at 10:15, and I don't want to live out of a suitcase for a week." And so we have this thing every single day leading up to any type of trip where she's like, "Have you packed your suitcase? We're going to be late." And inevitably, I promise you, I'm always on time. But I'm one of the people that's going to pack my suitcase probably the morning of, and it drives her insane. And what happens is the closer we get to going on our trip, maybe this is just my marriage, don't judge, maybe y'all ain't like this, but the closer it gets, the more detailed my wife gets. So like it'll be the night before we leave and she'll be like, "Have you packed your bag yet?" I'm like, "Nope, you said we're leaving tomorrow at 10:15, right?" "Yep, okay, well my bag will be ready and in the car at 10:15 tomorrow and we'll be ready to go." And she'll be like, "Well, you know what that means. It's gonna take you forever." I'm like, "It will be ready." And she's like, and then she gets more detailed. She's like, "Well, if you were to do it right now, just think about all the things you'd have to do, Curtis." She'd be like, "You have to get up off the couch. You have to walk up the stairs. You have to walk down the hallway. You have to go into our room. You have to turn the light on. You have to go into the closet. You have to get your shirts. You have to fold your shirts. You have to put the shirts in the suitcase. You have to close the suitcase. You have to zip the suitcase. You have to pull the little handle on the suitcase. You gotta take the," and I'm like, "Babe, it's not, like you're making this out to be like each step takes like 10 minutes. Like I'll get the thing packed, I promise." And so I just can't help but think, like, if I don't want to speak for my wife necessarily, I love my wife, but if she was Abraham, this story is like her worst nightmare. God says, go. And she'd be like, okay, just tell me where to go. And he's like, just put one foot in front of the other and I'll show you. She's like, nope, not happening. If she were Abraham, God would say, hey, I'm going to give you a son. And she said, okay, just give me the details. How are you going to do it? And he's like, I'll take care of that. Just follow me. This is a planner's nightmare, right? God says, sacrifice your son. Okay, sounds kind of crazy, but why first and how? And he's like, I'll show you later. Just climb. I mean, for us planners, I don't want to make light of this story. This is serious, but this is hard. And what I've come to know over 12 or so years of following God is that following God often means doing what God says, even when I don't have all the details. And now I need you to hear this very, very, very clearly. Before we go any farther, I need you to hear this. My message today, as awesome as Abraham's faith is, as awesome as an example of a hero of the faith is, my message today is not have more faith, exercise more faith, believe better, trust more. Because if I'm simply telling you to conjure up some more of something that's inside of yourself, then you are destined to be disappointed. I'm not here to give you a pep talk on the fervency of your faith. I'm here to make sure the object of your faith is the Lord Jesus Christ. Because then and only then will you experience peace even when you don't have all the particulars, because you are following Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who is your provider. This is why Abraham is so confident in his obedience. Because he knew who he was obeying even when he didn't have the entire what. I mean, it's fascinating. Look back at verse 2. Verse 2. God says, take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and then look at this. Go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. Did y'all catch that? It's super important, because the same way God deals with Abraham here, I think, is a lot of the way he deals in our life today. It's exactly how God operates. We want exactly where and when and how and why, but God says, go to the land of Moriah. Land could also be translated region. Go to the region of which I tell you, and once you get there, then on my timetable, I'll tell you which mountain. Not the place, the region. Don't miss this. This is hard, y'all. We think coming to God's gonna be kind of like a magic eight ball. He tells us exactly where to go, exactly what to do, exactly what job to take, exactly what to say. That's not how it happens. How often does God give you a general direction but doesn't let you know the final destination? How often do we desire to know the place that God is taking us to, but all he gives us is promises about who he is? How often does God operate by saying, go to the region and then I'll give you the specifics? Church, how much more would God show us if we took one step and began to walk the pathway of obedience? So often we don't get details before obedience. What Jehovah Jireh, what God has provided for us in the meantime is his word. His word, which lays out the principles and the promises and the parameters to live by. And often it's only when we choose to focus on these promises and live by these parameters and obey even when we don't have all the details, often it's then and only then that God will reveal to us the place that he has destined for us. It's right here in verse 4. Look. Verse 4 says, on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw, what? The place from afar. You'll never see the place if you are not first in the region. Friend, many of you have never scaled the mountain to experience God's great provision because you've never first taken the step of obedient faith and ventured into the region. You want to know what step 100 is, but God just wants you to take step one. And here's where this hopefully will be life-changing for you, because it means that you don't have to know the entire plan when you have the provider who is with you every step of the way. You get that? It means you don't have to have all the details to obey and trust the Lord that his promises when he has promised to provide. See, because I've come to know God like this and I know you can know God like this, it now means that I don't live by explanations, I live by promises. I believe God will prove his promises even when I don't have all the particulars. So I have to ask, are you even in the region of obedience today? Where in your life do you need to stop obsessing over the details and instead believe on God's promises despite your lack of details? Where in your life has God called you to obedience right now? Where have you yet to take the first step because you've been waiting on the full details? What area of your life are you holding on to tightly and rationalizing, saying, surely God wouldn't call me to give that up? If we could just be honest with ourselves today, are you searching for a place when you haven't even obeyed and going to the region? We have no right to expect the provision of God if we are not in the will of God. And where do we find the will of God if it's not in the Word of God? We have the Word of God. We have the promises of God. They're readily available at our fingertips. You probably have a handful of them laying around your house. You probably spend more time on your cell phone where there's like 72 different Bible apps. So take the promises of God, pray the promises of God, pour over the promises of God, and then proclaim the promises of God over your life, knowing that God has said his name is provider in your life, and he will provide those promises. Knowing God as Jehovah Jireh means that I can trust his promises instead of obsessing over the particulars. It's such a free way to live. The second way, knowing God as Jehovah Jireh, means that problems are actually opportunities for God to prove his faithfulness. Problems are opportunities for God to prove his faithfulness. Now see, from Abraham's perspective, he faced a problem. What God wanted to do through Isaac in blessing all the nations of the world, and what God has commanded him to do to Isaac in killing him, seem to stand in contradiction, right? Now, let's remember, this is a three-day journey. A three-day journey where he's wrestling with this seeming contradiction. If I'm him, I can't imagine the doubts and the fears and the questions that filled his mind during a three-day journey. 3 days is plenty of time to change your mind. 3 days is plenty of time to devise another scheme or think of a loophole. 3 days is plenty of time to justify why this makes absolutely no sense and to U-turn on this whole thing. Can't help but think how many of us have stepped out on a journey of faith only to turn back within 3 days because we've rationalized why it wouldn't make sense for God to call us to some form of radical obedience. And we don't know a ton about this three-day journey. Scripture doesn't tell us a ton. What we do know, however, is that over the course of 3 days, Abraham decided that this problem was an opportunity for God to prove his faithfulness and come through on his promises. How do we know that? We'd go over to the New Testament. Hebrews chapter 11, the Hall of Faith, tells us in verse 19 that Abraham reasoned that God could raise the dead. So here he is, stuck with this problem. He's walking along. He doesn't know how or why or when or what, but instead of disobeying God's instructions and doubting God's promises, Abraham was focused on who he knew God to be, that God was provider, that he is Jehovah Jireh. So Abraham gets busy brainstorming how God might make all of this work together for his good, and the solution he comes up with, the best he's got, is resurrection. He's like, I don't know, but I mean, perhaps this is how God's gonna do it. After I kill my son, after the sacrifice, God's just gonna raise him from the dead because God has promised to bless the entire world through him, and God always keeps his promises, so that's the best I got. Now, I want us to be careful here because with that being said, it's important for us to hold these, let's call them holy brainstorms in our mind very lightly. Abraham, for instance, was not right in the way that he imagined God was going to work. And often we are not gonna be right in the way that we imagine God is going to work. And that's okay. It's one of the reasons I love this verse, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 19, because Abraham is still commended for his faith, even though he made a wrong guess about what God would do next. Now listen, this sounds simplistic, but this is the assurance that you can have in life if you come to know God as Jehovah Jireh. Because you can believe that God is going to work out a seemingly impossible problem and in the end, prove his faithfulness, even if he does it in a way in which you don't anticipate. Here's what I've come to know. This is why I love this name of God. If you come to know God as provider, then you will have peace in believing that life's problems are actually portals for God to prove his faithfulness, because you are now relying on his promises, not on your picture of how you believe everything should turn out. And this is encouraging. It should be, at least. Because for some of you today, you are walking up your own mountain with Isaac. And I would love to tell you that it's going to be an easy walk and God's going to provide and everything's going to turn out great in the end. But I just can't promise all those things for you. What I can promise is, as you march up the mountain with your proverbial Isaac, that God is with you. That God has you. That he has promised to see to it. And you may not know how, you may not know when, but God is there and God will provide. It was believing this character, believing this name of God, that's what drove Abraham up this mountain. It was not the strength of Abraham's own faith. It was not Abraham marching up this thing over and over saying, I can do it, I can do it, I can do it. It was the strength of God's character and faithfulness toward Abraham. It was him repeating, God is faithful, God is provider, God is good, God is loving, God fulfills his promises. And so you know what I believe Abraham was doing over this three-day journey? I believe he was doing just that. I believe he was rehearsing the promises of God. He was saying, I remember in Genesis 12, I remember in Genesis 15, I remember in Genesis 18, the thing God has promised, the things he said he was going to accomplish in my life. He's rehearsing the character of God, that God is loving and faithful and true, that God is provider. He's rehearsing the faithfulness of God and what God has already provided. He's saying, God, you've given me a son. God, you've blessed me. God, you've brought me through so many things. So when Isaac says, hey, Dad, where's the offering? All of Abraham's thoughts and ponderings and contemplations and faith are summed up in three words. He says, son, God will provide. And can I just take a second? This is so good when I was studying this week. I've never seen this in my entire life. And I just want to say something specifically to parents here. Crawford Loritz, who's our very own pastor, Brian Loritz, that's his daddy. His dad just retired from being a pastor. Crawford Loritz says the greatest thing that we can do as parents is one, he says, is to heighten the word of God and help our kids keep their minds filled with scripture. So number one, heighten the word of God in our homes. And then he says, number two, we should talk about God's ability to step into every situation in our lives. So talk about scripture, talk about God's sovereignty. In verse 6, listen to this, parents, I'm telling you, lock right back in with me. Verse 6 gives us an example of why this is so important. Because in verse 6, we read that it's Isaac, not Abraham, that carried the wood. Now, why is that important? Because that means that Isaac is not some scrawny little boy, okay? Isaac's not some chubby toddler. At minimum, this is a big, strapping teenager who is strong enough to carry all this stuff. In fact, some scholars say he is anywhere from age 16 to age 34. I'm not kidding. Which means Isaac could have easily outran, out-wrestled, or flat out just got out of this situation if he wanted to. Not sure about you, but I'm taking the 20-year-old over the 120-year-old in a fist fight or a track race any day of the week. So now we get the picture of what's really happening here. Abraham, listen, this is, I'm telling you, Abraham was only able to tie Isaac down to the altar because Isaac was willing to be tied down. Why was Isaac willing? I have to believe it's because his father's faith and the God of the impossible had rubbed off on him. I have to believe that he believed what his father had said in verse 8 when he said, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. And if God chose him to be the lamb, well, then God knows best. Parents, hear me clearly. Kids like that do not come out of nowhere. Kids like that don't come out of families that are thoroughly moral, but only marginally Christian. Kids like that come out of families where Christ has come to have first place in absolutely everything. Kids like that come from families who follow the Holy Spirit and trust God's promises, even when they don't have all the particulars. Young Isaacs, y'all, young Isaacs from the Summit Church are not going to come out of nowhere. Young Isaacs come from parents whom they observe obeying the Lord even when it's tough. They come from parents who believe and live as though they believe that the Lord will provide. In fact, I just can't get over this part. When God chose to test Abraham, who do you think the test was for? I mean, God wasn't proving Abraham's faith to God. God already knows Abraham's heart. And I can't help but think that neither was God proving Abraham's faith to Abraham. Abraham already knew his own heart as well. So in some ways, who is this test for? Who's the only person present in this story who doesn't have access to the heart of Abraham? It's Isaac. Moms and dads, you have such an incredible opportunity to demonstrate your faith in God, who is our provider, especially during crisis and hardship and conflict and confusion for your children. This is so convicting to me. I can't help but ask myself the question, what is my life teaching to my children about God's character? Is God truly the Lord of your household? Does your schedule say that Jireh is more important or the gym? Do you spend more time at the dinner table discussing material things or the Messiah? I'll say it one more time. Young Isaacs don't come out of families that are thoroughly moral, but only marginally Christian. They come from families where Christ, where Jehovah Jireh has come to have first place in absolutely everything. And the last way that knowing God as Jehovah Jireh has changed my life, that it means that no matter what happens in this life, my eternity is secure. You see, something way more important than Abraham's impressive obedience is demonstrated to us here in Genesis chapter 22. What's demonstrated to us is God's commitment to us. See, just as Abraham was about to drop the knife on Isaac, at the last moment, God shouts, stop, and supplies a sacrifice, a ram. And so in verse 14, Abraham called the name of that place. Here's our word, the Lord will provide. As it's said to this day, on the mount of the Lord, it shall be provided. I told you earlier, Jehovah Jireh is directly translated, the Lord will see to it. In other words, yes, God will provide, and he'll see to it. And in seeing to it, he'll be seen. He sees a need. He supplies and provides for the need. And in supplying the need, he is seen as having been seen to our need, and his glory is seen and put on display. This is awesome. Abraham, what he does, he names this anonymous mountaintop not by a name that's going to remind him of his problem or his trials or even his own obedience. He names it by a name that proclaims God's faithfulness and provision. He names it Jehovah Jireh. See, Isaac, church, is just a picture of the provision and the sacrifice that God would one day make on our behalf because of our sin through his very own son, Jesus. I mean, just think about it. This is Genesis chapter 22. We're nowhere near the New Testament, y'all. Isaac and Jesus, both sons of a promise given many years before their birth, both born of miracles, both firstborns who are loved by their fathers. Isaac and Jesus, who both go on a 3-day journey to arrive at their very own place of sacrifice and carried their sacrificial wood on their own backs. Isaac and Jesus both willingly laid down their lives to their father. Isaac and Jesus, as they're being sacrificed, both ask a question at the moment when it's about to happen. Isaac, who Abraham reckons was brought back from the dead figuratively, and Jesus, who is brought back from the dead literally. Abraham promised Isaac that God would provide a lamb, and friend, Jesus Christ is that lamb. But that's where the similarities between Isaac and Jesus end, because for Jesus, there was no ram in the thicket. For Jesus, there was no substitute. See, God the Father went through with what Abraham the Father didn't have to. God sacrificed his son, his one and only son, for the sake of sinners. God did not spare his own son, but delivered him up on a cross for us all, for all of our sin, for all of our shame, for all of our guilt, for all of our doubt. And in that moment for Jesus, there couldn't be a substitute because Jesus was our substitute. Jesus is the one who took your place on the cross. He took my place on the cross. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brings us peace was on him. And now by his wounds, we are healed. And he did it all because he loves you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. You need to hear this because no matter how much faith we have, no matter how much good we do, no matter how many times we attend church, no matter how much Bible we know, we cannot erase the fact that we are sinners and we stand guilty before a holy God, which means apart from God, you and I sit in the very place of Isaac in verse 10 with God's knife of judgment raised above us, ready to come down on our throats as a just and right penalty for our sins against his holiness and justice. That's the bad news, but this is why the gospel is such good news. There we are, the knife of judgment about to come down. But God shows his love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses and sins, makes us alive together with Christ. It is by grace we have been saved through faith. It is not our own work. It is not our own doing. It is the gift of God, nothing we can do, not a result of our works, so that none of us may boast. Church, sin, just like anything else, cannot be in two places at once. So if God took my sin, laid it on his son, then it cannot be on me anymore. That's the good news of the gospel. If Jesus bore the wrath of God for me, I cannot bear that wrath, for God so loved the world that he gave his son to bear the wrath that we deserved. God gave, God provided, God saw to it that we needed a Savior, and he sent his son, Jehovah Jireh, and now we give glory to the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. But we can only have him if we, like Abraham, trust that God will provide the Lamb. Can't provide it through our own good works. Can't provide it through our own moral standing. We can only have him if we, like Abraham, stop trying to create our own solutions and submit ourselves and our lives and everything in them to God. The question is obvious. Have you done that? If not, then today you can know who God is and how he has provided, and you can believe and behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Why don't we bow our heads? At all of our locations, let's bow our heads. You know, there's two groups of people, I think. I think everybody falls into one of these two in some ways. The first group are for those of you that have never done that. You've never beheld the Lamb of God who has taken away your sin. And maybe today, for the very first time, you've realized you've come to see God as Jehovah Jireh, as provider, in providing for your eternity and giving Jesus to you. And today you are ready to receive him. That's one group of people. Then there's another group of people who, you hear me talking about God as provider and how we can have peace and freedom and all these things, and you may love God, you're seeking to obey God, you want to do whatever he's calling you to do, go wherever he's sending you, but at the end of the day, the last 6, 12, 18 months, God has felt like anything but provider in your life. That you've not seen God as provider, you feel like you've suffered loss, and you've suffered relationally, and you've suffered in your health, and you've suffered financially, and you've had all these things happen, and you're saying, I have not been experiencing God as provider in any way, shape, or form. And you are yearning, you are begging to see God as provider.
Hey friends, in the service right now, Curtis is about to call two groups forward, but we want to make sure this is really clear for you online specifically. So the first group I want to speak to is those of you who have not received the salvation that Christ offers. Listen, we have an eternal hope in Christ. We have a future because of his death, burial, and resurrection. And he's offering that to you as a free gift today. Are you ready to receive it? We want to have a conversation with you. So text the word READY, R-E-A-D-Y, to 33933 so we can begin that journey with you. Now, the second group. Maybe some of you don't know God as provider. Maybe this past year has actually been a season of loss and suffering. We want to pray with you and for you. So if you're watching live, you have two options. First, you can click request prayer and someone will pray with you right now. Or if you feel comfortable, go ahead and ask for prayer right there in the chat. And those of you that don't need prayer, I still want you to get involved. All I want you to do is type out a prayer. Seriously, in that live chat, go ahead and type out a prayer. I would love to see all of us typing prayers and asking the Lord to provide for one another today. If you're watching on demand, take this time to pray for one another in your home group. Or we'd be happy to follow up with you this week if you email us at prayer@summitchurch.com. As you're doing that now, let's continue to worship.
You came from heaven's throne, acquainted with our sorrow, to trade the debt we owe, your suffering for our freedom.
Amen Summit. What an incredible time of worship. If the Lord is drawing you to himself today and you're ready to receive the salvation that Christ offers, text the word READY to 33933 and someone from our staff will follow up with you.
And if you want someone to pray with you, it's not too late for that either. Go ahead and click Request Prayer or email us at prayer@summitchurch.com.
Summit, I pray that you experience God as your provider this week. You are sent.